So, hello everyone. So, when I was asked to do this, as to bring together the various threads of the discussions and try to synthesize, I was basically trying to think of like, what is the main question that I came to with the course? Because I was also hoping for like, to learn over the course of these 3 days. And for me, as like a feminist, I think when I think about the question of digital technologies and women's empowerment, one of the questions that bothers me very much is also that of the structures of technology. In the sense that the main question that I brought with me to the course was to try and understand what technology structures can facilitate social transformation. Because ultimately, when we talk about women's empowerment, we are talking about changing gender relations, changing power relations, as everyone has already so beautifully laid out in this panel. And so what struck me, what I will do right now is to try and bring together a series of things that struck me over the course of these 2 days, and then I'll leave you with my thoughts at that, because I don't think, I mean, I have like any major conclusion to offer or anything like that. So at the end of the panel yesterday, at the end of the MKSS panel, Nikhilji said that, you know, in the whole stories that we heard of Mr. Sanjay Sahni and Northi ji and everyone, the technology really played a crucial, role in the whole story, but it was fairly minor. Now, thinking about that, I don't want to really, go in the direction of talking about how minor or major technology is to transformation, because I really think that in any historical moment, when there are a combination of factors, there are a lot of things that influence change, and everything has a role to play in that mix. And as Anita and Prabir were putting it in the afternoon panel today, technologies and societies co-constitute each other, so it's sometimes very difficult to unpack an event after it has happened to say this exactly was the role of technology and this exactly was the social or non-technological factor. So, I don't think that would be a fruitful exercise, but instead I would like to reflect on what I learned over the past 2 days on what are the conditions under which technology can be transformational. Or what are the conditions under which technology does become crucial when we talk about this question? So basically, in my mind, it comes to me that there are 3 main caveats when we think about this. From the discussions yesterday and today morning, it was like fairly clear that there is immense potential to utilize digital technologies, especially the internet, to build a public information architecture that is open and democratic. It is another matter about the extent to which, this is actually being realized, because we did hear yesterday from Soumya Kidambi on the panel about how the whole logic of digital data and collecting MIS follows an upward rather than a downward logic, and how information is not particularly sorted out and contextualized in locally relevant formats, and even the language is not the local language. So many issues were raised. But in spite of that, in spite of its imperfections, we heard this wonderful story about how the NAREGA MIS, NREGA MIS that is out there online, and what it can do. And, in spite of that struggle to read that data set, something did happen, and that is because there is a law that has been effectively utilized to proactively disclose public information in a digital way. And so if we think about it, there is so much more that can be done in that direction. And when we build information systems, like all the panelists already identified yesterday and even today morning in the discussion this came up, if we think of public information from the logic of the community, or praja information systems, if you will, rather than think of it as this tool to ensure that your monitoring and efficiency is perfect, it may be eventually so transformational. And also the other aspect of new information architecture that is coming up, we discussed about how digital technologies increase the capacity of the state to collect data about each of its citizens. And in this age, it's possible to map data sets of such variety and such immense size that was probably never before possible. And here, this important question was raised by both Sumandru and Param on when we build these kind of data systems, what is the logic? For whom are these data sets being built? And who is constructing them? What are the ideologies and biases that construct them? And also, as Rohini had pointed out earlier, many of these dominant data systems, they often invisibilize women and women's concerns. And in fact, Sumandru had shared a reading, but he did not refer to it in his presentation, about when we talk about gender and existing data sets, there are a series of gaps that have been identified. In fact, over 50, 60 key gaps in which there is no gender disaggregated data even. And here I think that we also are talking about the question of control, in the sense that right now the community is seen as the space from which you extract all this information and you do what you want with it. But if you can actually design a system where community members control what kind of data is being collected for what purposes, and they hold full sovereignty over it, in a sense a decentralized data architecture, there is a lot of potential there. The second caveat I want to go to is again something that Mr. Sanjay said in his presentation about how it was like so effective, because even though there were many others in the village who had undergone digital literacy training, it was only he who was able to dig out exactly this kind of information, because the others were not really able to understand how to dig out what they needed from the net. And this I want to connect to the debates we had today morning, especially what Ms. Sharda Muralidharan was referring to about the kind of trainings and the kind of capacity building we are talking about for women in terms of digital literacy. Because I think we need to, I think Janvi mentioned this point now, that we shouldn't be thinking of digital literacy in the sense of just a capacity to handle a gadget or a particular software platform. Actually, it's about, in a contextual way, how are you using this new information and communication possibility? And also, to try and understand, in this new information and communication field, what are the politics of it? What is being structured? The whole thing we have been hearing this morning, that usually gets totally left out in a digital literacy discourse. Then finally, I think that it's also important to understand that ICTs can be really transformational only if we look at them as global public goods and if we think of them outside the market paradigm. Prabir had already laid out the whole politics of ICTs and the platforms, and it is also important to understand the same kind of politics operate when it comes to accessing the basic hardware and the infrastructure itself. And the importance of public provisioning and the state's role in this has also been pointed out. And needless to say, even when we are making public provisioning and public access programs, to gender them and to talk about what kind of issues women face in coming to these public access points, how you handle that, handling women's concerns, that is also especially important. And I just want to share with you this one statistic that, in fact, hardly one-third of the countries in the world today, I mean out of the countries who have a national broadband plan, they refer to the word gender in their plan. This is like a ITU statistic. And it's pretty shocking, because yesterday in the group also we've discussed like many times how women face a different set of barriers and challenges when it comes to accessing public access points and technology. Finally, I just want to leave you with one thought, that I think that, as it has been pointed out yesterday and today, the question of regulation is extremely important, because if we have to make technology transformational, it is important to understand who is going to maintain a checks and balance on these spaces and who is going to ensure that rights violations do not take place. Thank you. I thought my time was up.
1 minute.
Okay. So this is something my colleague Anita often says, okay, about how right now in today's context, when we think of the relationship between the global and the local, what's happening today is that the local is entirely cast as subservient to the global. In fact, and because of this, because of how the dominant framing of political economy works today, when you want to think local or even plan local, you cannot do without like thinking of the larger structures like global structures. And this is especially true, like as it when it comes to the question of making emancipatory technology frameworks. In the morning, we heard like countless times about how nation-state sovereignties are no longer respected. So when we talk about rights and online rights, if my rights offline also have to be guaranteed online, who's going to guarantee that? I mean, with a traditional nation-state framework becomes really inadequate. And so we need to think of like a new ethical-legal framework. I do not know the answer to that. And I think that's like really something we should strive for.